Hello and welcome to the next instalment of my videos on organic chemistry. We're going to focus on the general properties and reactions of the alkanes. Okay, well, you should know what the alkanes are, and that they are the simplest family of hydrocarbons. And you should also be comfortable with drawing displayed structures of molecules by now as well. The first six alkanes, very simply, we've got one carbon, four hydrogens. This one is called methane. When we've got two carbons, that is called ethane. When we've got three carbons, that is called propane. Four is butane, five is pentane, and six is hexane. Now, these are only the straight chain alkanes. There are branched ones as well. I'm not going to go into that here, but you will need to be able to represent branched alkanes as well. They are part of the same homologous series. That is, that they differ from each other by a CH2 unit. And what I mean by that here is the difference between methane and ethane is the addition of a CH2 unit. The difference between ethane and propane is also a CH2 unit. And in that sense, we can actually say that the alkanes, because they're part of a homologous series, they have a general formula. And that is this, in that if we have n number of carbon atoms, we must have 2n plus 2 atoms of hydrogen in that molecule. And this is true for both linear and branched alkanes. Because they're part of a homologous series, they actually tend to have very similar properties, which change as, or gradually change as the molecules gradually change as well. Okay, so for the boiling point, as the chain increases across here, so this is chain length going across the x-axis, then the boiling point also increases as we increase those chains. Okay, and similar for the melting point. There are similar to the viscosity also increases as well. And the other thing is what you can see on here is that these four, well, their boiling point is below room temperature. So these are going to be gases, okay? And then everything here are going to be liquid. And it's only when we get here that we start seeing solid alkanes at room temperature. Well, why is it this trend? Well, I want to give you some things to think about. Moving from a liquid to a gas requires energy, because if we think back to our particle model, we've got our liquid particles are all very close to each other, our gas molecules are far apart, so we've got to separate them from a liquid state to a gaseous state. But molecules are attracted to each other in what are known as intermolecular forces. Okay. And the longer the chain length, the more chance there is that there's going to be some sort of interaction between the molecules, and therefore there's going to be an overall stronger attraction between those molecules the longer they are. And the stronger the overall force of attraction, the higher the boiling point, because the more energy you're going to need to put into it in the first place. So hopefully there's a nice logical progression to the argument there. But what I do want to do is give you some sort of analogy to this. So if I take a piece of wood and I take another piece of wood and I stick some Velcro to either one of them, and I can stick those together and then I can pull them apart. But what if I had longer bits of wood with a bit more Velcro on them? Once they're stuck together, they're going to be harder to pull apart. And again, if I get an even longer piece of wood, with even more Velcro, even more opportunities for some sort of attraction between them, then it's going to be even harder to pull apart. And this is my analogy for trying to explain the boiling point increase as we increase the chain length of our alkanes. We've also got this idea of linear versus branched. Okay, straight linear molecules have a higher boiling point than their branched counterparts. For the same number of carbon atoms, linear molecules will have a higher boiling point. And this is because the linear molecule has lots of opportunities to interact, whereas the branched molecules, they can't get as close to each other. They don't fit as nicely into each other as they otherwise would. So they have less chance of interaction, therefore less overall intermolecular forces of attraction, and therefore less energy is required, which means a lower boiling point for the branched molecules. Now we're going to get on to the reactions of alkanes. Well, the reactions of alkanes are few, okay? Alkanes are, they only contain strong single covalent bonds. And we've already discussed that they don't really have any functional group of their own. And therefore, we would probably consider them as quite unreactive. Well, yes, they are, but there are two really important reactions that you need to know about. The first one is combustion, and the second one is substitution. So I'm going to deal with these each in turn. So combustion first. Well, alkanes burn in oxygen and they give out energy in what is known as an exothermic reaction. It gives heat out to the environment. Two examples of this are here. Okay, so we've got methane and we've got ethane here. Both are burning in oxygen and they are going to give, both of them, only giving carbon dioxide and water, different numbers of each because of the balancing of the equations. But what's really important here is this. Because the products of the reaction are only carbon dioxide and water, we say that this is a complete combustion. There is enough oxygen here, there is enough oxygen present to completely oxidize, to completely combust the fuel. However, in the absence of enough oxygen, we might get carbon monoxide, or we might even get carbon, or we tend to call this soot. And this is known as incomplete combustion. And there's a difference there that you are required to know about as well. Okay. Moving on to substitution reactions. Well, substitution reactions will undergo what are known as substitution reactions with halogens in the presence of ultraviolet lights, for example, from the sun. And they are called substitution reactions because one of the hydrogen atoms has been replaced by an atom of the halogen that you're doing a reaction with. So here I've got methane with bromine, and I'm going to make bromomethane and hydrogen bromide. Diagrammatically, what we've done is I'm going to remove this and substitute it here. The left-hand side, the mixture of methane and bromine is orange, but when you expose it to UV light, over time, it will decolorize and the mixture will become colorless. And this shows that a reaction has occurred. Just for those of you that are interested and are thinking about going on to other to further chemistry, this is a type of free radical reaction, but I'm not going to go into that in this video. They're quite difficult to control, these reactions, and sometimes multiple substitutions can occur. So if I take methane again and I take bromine, I might actually, instead of putting one bromine, I might put two on. And in this case, I've substituted this one and this hydrogen, both of them with bromine. Again, you won't know the difference between the mono substitution and the di substitution here, because all we end up with is we start off with an orange solution, we end up with a colorless solution, but we've got different products. The other issue with this is that on large molecules, it is possible you might end up with a mixture of isomers. So if we take propane now with bromine, then I make bromopropane. But the bromine can be in this position, or it can be in this position. And these are very different. And from naming these compounds, we can say that this is one bromopropane and that this is two bromopropane. That is what you need to know about the alkanes. Thank you very much for listening. I know it's a little bit longer than usual, but there was a lot to get through. Keep on watching these videos, learn lots of organic chemistry, and have fun while you're doing it. Thank you very much. Bye bye.